Hi viewers, today's presentation is for the Honda OBD1 Live Data Scanner reading, episode number 2. I am going to show you the basic information signals that are sent to the ECU and also the three control signals that the ECU generates to manage air fuel mixture and spark advance. Let's begin. For the episode number 2, I equipped my Honda Del Sol 1993 with a permanent coupling harness installation, fully compatible with my OBD2 scanner. To know more about the pinout that I used to build my harness, and also the step-by-step procedure to select the live data, please refer to the episode number 1. I do not need all the live data available with the scanner to make a basic diagnostic. I have chosen only 10 of them that are useful to know when the engine is running in open loop or in closed loop conditions. In general, an engine runs in open loop condition when it is cold and warming up. During that warming period, the engine is running without the oxygen sensor monitoring. When the engine is warmed up and the O2 sensor reaches a temperature around 600 degrees Fahrenheit, the closed loop is activated. Then, the O2 sensor signals sent to the ECU are used to adjust the air fuel mixture. I begin my data readings with the engine speed, and the following data will be selected with the order displayed by my scanner. If you remove the distributor cap and the coil assembly, you can see three pickup sensors. The three of them send 4-volt AC signals. The crankshaft position sensor has 24 teeth and sends an AC pulse for each 15 degree increment. The top dead center position sensor has 4 teeth and sends an AC pulse each time a piston is in firing position. The cylinder position sensor has only 1 tooth and sends an AC pulse when the piston number 1 is in firing position. Let's start with the live data readings. The engine speed displayed by the scanner is the result of the calculated pulses coming from the crankshaft position sensor that are processed by the ECU. The second one is the engine coolant temperature sensor. It is a thermistor that sends a variable voltage to the ECU. When there is a change in coolant temperature, the sensor resistance is modified. The sensor is located on the engine, just under the distributor. I select ECT sensor. Actually, the engine is warming up, and you can see that the temperature is rising in my ECT displays. The next section is another temperature signal. The intake air temperature sensor is also a thermistor like the one used for the coolant temperature. The IAT sensor is located on the intake manifold facing the firewall. I select IAT sensor, but this time the temperature is lower than the coolant temperature because the air in my garage is around 60 degrees Fahrenheit or 26 degrees Celsius. The air density present in the intake manifold needs to be calculated. It is the MAP sensor that measures the atmospheric air pressure. The change in pressure will modify the voltage values sent to the ECU. Since my car is not equipped with a mass air flow sensor, my manifold absolute pressure sensor is the most important air measurement for the engine. The MAP sensor is installed on the throttle assembly. Also, in the absolute pressure section, I included the barometric sensor. This sensor reads the atmospheric pressure outside of the intake manifold. This extra information completes the measurements provided by the MAP sensor. The ECU can then control the air-fuel mixture in different atmospheric conditions and altitudes. The baro sensor is mounted on the ECU circuit board. Because the MAP and baro sensors work together, I select two graphics per display. The normal atmospheric pressure at sea level is usually 14.7 psi. When the engine is running with a closed throttle, the PSI is a lot lower than normal atmospheric pressure. But when the engine is running with a full open throttle, the PSI is closer to the normal atmospheric pressure. When a driver presses on the acceleration pedal, it opens the throttle and rotates the TPS at the same time. The throttle position sensor is a potentiometer, and when it rotates, the variation in voltage sent to the ECU should be from 0.5 volt to 4.5 volts. There is around 50 millivolts of variation for every degrees of rotation. As you can see on the picture, the TPS is mounted on the left side of the throttle assembly.
To read the TPS data, I do not need the engine to be running. I only need the ECU to be powered. The scanner shows in degrees the angle of the throttle plate. Depending on the calibration, it is closed at 0 degree and it is fully opened at 80 degrees. To adjust the air-fuel ratio, the oxygen sensor is a very important component. In a closed loop, the oxygen sensor is used to measure the quantity of oxygen present in the exhaust. The O2 sensor sends voltage pulses to the ECU. These pulses should be between 0.1 volt and 0.9 volt with a cycle of 1 to 5 Hz. The oxygen sensor is installed on the exhaust manifold in front of the engine. For this selection, I used two graphic displays to show the interaction between the oxygen sensor and the RPM. Note that in 1993, Honda did not provide the short-term trims, neither the long-term trims. Therefore, I do not know if the displayed values are corrected from rich or lean conditions. The idle air control valve is controlled by the ECU. The solenoid inside the valve assembly is driven by pulse width modulation signals. The intake manifold has two idle air valve systems. One is a mechanical thermowax system, and the other one is PWM controlled. The PWM IAC valve is located on the intake manifold, beside the throttle assembly, facing the firewall. You can see on my scanner that it displays the values in milliamps. This measurement indicates that the ECU is controlling the air valve, but there is no percentage duty cycle information. Personally, I prefer to obtain the PWM information from a DSO or a standard oscilloscope. Actually, my IAC frequency is 488 pulses per second with duty cycles from 35 to 65%. More than 25 years ago, Honda was able to produce a very lean and efficient EFI system. It uses simple data that are sent to the ECU. Then, the selected fuel table calculates the quantity of fuel to be injected in cylinders to obtain an optimal air-fuel ratio. The ECU manages the timing and the duration of the fuel that is sprayed. It turns on and off the solenoids that control the pintles. The fuel injectors are mounted between the fuel rail and the intake manifold, close to the engine head. Based on RPM and multiple data, the solenoids are energized in milliseconds. In this presentation, it goes from 1.94 milliseconds to 3.39 milliseconds. Also, during one deceleration, I removed my foot from the acceleration pedal, and the injector cutoff strategy was applied. During that moment, the fuel injection time indicated 0 milliseconds. To be able to control the spark advance, the ECU needs to get a well-synchronized ignition timing signal. The distributor must first be adjusted with a timing light. The basic ignition timing for my VTEC engine is 16 degrees plus minus 2 degrees. The ECU needs this basic ignition timing setup combined with other data inputs to be able to generate a proper spark advance control signal. The igniter located in the distributor receives from the ECU the on and off ignition signals required to control the voltage sent to the coil assembly. After, when the secondary coil magnetic field collapses, it fires a spark plug. I select engine speed and spark advance to show the interactive results. Note that the spark advance can go from 17 to 36 degrees when I change the RPM. Remember that my basic advance timing is 16 degrees and that the variations in degrees are calculated with the ignition timing tables.
That's all for this presentation. I hope you had a chance to learn something and that you liked it.